1, 2, 1, 2, 3. I was headed out your door, determined that I would go, when a tornado warning came on a music show. I was scared of the howling wind blowing around the town, so I quickly changed my plans and I settled down. Yeah, but it was no tornado at all. You know, I felt so warm and calm that I swear it was a false alarm. I was saved by the warmest part of your soul. I looked to the east, birds were flying by. I looked to the west, I saw a darkened sky. All of the world was turning, all in that dreadful storm.
Okay, we're back. So listen, we've done some really cool tapes, really cool episodes. We've done some funny things, always funny things. We've done some serious stuff, which has been kind of hard on me, actually, some of those last few videos I did. And now we're just kind of getting through my life. So now we're at a stage in my life where I'm probably, let's just say I'm in my mid-20s. You know, met my wife, got married, you know, the eye candy girl, you know, got married, married her, really had no idea who she was. I'm only kidding. She was very, very nice. And I make a lot of jokes. I don't mean to be disrespectful to anybody. But in any case, though, so now here I am with long hair and not a really good job, the factory job. There's only so many batons you could put together. So I decided there was a friend of my parents. Her name was Jane Lynch. She was such a sweet woman. And she, every time she met me at one of my parents' parties, she would tell my parents, "Your son is just so smart. He can definitely go places. Let me help him get a job at the bank." So she wanted me to work at this bank. It was called European American Bank. Now that bank doesn't exist anymore, probably because they hired me for a while. I probably ruined the place. No, I'm kidding. She kept saying, "I'll get you a job in the bank." And I said, "Well, okay, maybe I can do that. I'm good with numbers and things like that." And she said, "Well, but you have to cut your hair." And I'd always say, "I'm not cutting my hair." Mm-hmm. She's like, "Well, you can't work in the bank with a ponytail." This is like 1975 or something. And I said, "Well, I'm not cutting my hair." And I held out for probably 6 months. And my parents were on my case. So finally, I said, "All right, Mrs. Lynch, I'll cut my hair and I'll take the job." So I cut my hair and I got an interview. And of course, I passed the interview because Mrs. Lynch was a big wheel. And it wasn't like this was some big, important bank job. It was, they hired me as a teller. I'm like, you got to start at the bottom, especially when you got no college. But it was pretty cool. So I said, okay, I'll do it. So I bought a bunch of suits and ties, and I start going to the bank. And I show up. And they show me how to, you know, do teller stuff. I got to tell you, being a teller at a bank is probably the most difficult job I've ever had. It was not an easy job. If you had a million transactions, and this is back before they had those machines where people, these debit machines and stuff, where people walk up and use their card and do their own. You couldn't do anything online back then. You had to do every transaction you did had to be done in the bank. So like on Fridays, when people got their checks, and back then they got a check, there was no money that went into your account automatically. You actually were given a check at the end of the week. And you took that check and you went to the bank. At 3 or 4 o'clock, we'd have lines out the door of people wanting to cash checks. So as a teller, we were doing thousands of transactions, cashing checks, counting out money, giving it out. And I mean, the odds of making a mistake were very good, actually. And if you didn't prove up at night, at the end of the day, you had to count all your money, count all your checks. And if you were off by like more than a dollar or two, you were in big trouble. If you were off by like 10 bucks, you had to stay and figure out where you made the mistake. You're off by 100 bucks, you got put on probation. You did that twice, you were fired. Unbelievable. So I can remember being totally paranoid at this bank. And I can remember many nights staying after work, 6, 7 o'clock at night, going through tapes. Back then it was like rolls of like adding machine tapes and counting stuff up all the time. Really, really tough job. I remember one time, and then when I was, again, I was a new teller, they put me on the drive-up window. Everybody hated the drive-up window. The reason why was because when you were on the drive-up window, you had to cover the drive-up during like dinner hour. See, back then on Fridays, the banks were open until like 8, 9 o'clock at night. So there was a dinner hour. The bank would close at like 5, and then it would reopen at like six or seven for 9 hours. But between five and six, somebody had to work the drive-up window while everybody else went to went to dinner. So they put me on the drive-up. I'm like a new teller. I had no idea what I was doing. I'm by myself now. And I'm trying to do these transactions, and there's the line's getting long. All of a sudden, I hear people blowing their horns back there. What's going on? People walk in. I was frantic. So being a teller was a very, very crazy job. So, but I didn't take the job at the bank to be a teller. I took the job at the bank because I thought I was going to be a banker, you know, a big money guy or something like that. Of course, I had no idea what that meant. So anyway, I worked as a teller. And then after 6 months, they promoted me to head teller, which was a pretty fast advancement from what I was told. And then I'm like the boss, even though I wasn't very good at what I did, but I was the boss. Eventually, I got pretty good at it. Then all of a sudden, they started bringing in these college kids. Now, I'm about 22 now, maybe 23, maybe even more, maybe 24. I don't remember. But and I was the head teller. Well, there was a lot of these college kids that would go to college, and they'd come out, and they would get on these management programs, and they would bring these kids in, and they'd bring them to me. And they'd say, well, Kevin, here's the kids. These five kids are on a management training program, and we want you to show them all the things that tellers do, all the things that head tellers do, all the things that, you know, the foreign exchange people do and the new accounts people, because I kind of knew it all. I started getting pretty good at this banking thing, so I got good at it. Well, I can't tell you how many of these kids I trained, and I showed them everything I knew. And in 6 months, they were assistant managers, and I was still a stinking head teller, right? I was like, wait a minute. So finally, one day, I went to the manager. His name was Fred. I said, Fred, I want to talk to you about something. He goes, yeah. I said, so, you know, I'm training a lot of these kids and stuff. He goes, yeah, you're doing a great job. I said, yeah, I know. I said, but so what I want to know is, when do I get on the coffee drinking roller skating program? And he goes, what? I said, you know, the management program where these kids come in, they drink coffee with you, and they roller skate right past me and they become assistant managers and I'm still a head teller. I said, when do I get on that program? And he goes, well, it takes a certain amount of seasoning to qualify for these programs. That's what he told me. Seasoning, right? I said, you mean a sheepskin? See, I had no college. I never went to college. I was a street kid, and these were college kids. And, of course, he wasn't going to say, you need college. I was smarter than all these chucklehead kids. But they had college degrees, and I didn't. So he would say, no, it's not the college degree. You got to have a sheepskin. Not a sheepskin. You got to have a certain amount of, you know, seasoning. So I saw the writing on the wall. You know what? That was kind of discrimination in my mind. Here I was a hippie, never went to school, finally got myself a job at a bank, moved up the ladder to head teller, not much of a ladder, right? And then I can't go any further. So I'm thinking that was kind of like discrimination. You know, I probably should have picketed, but I didn't. You know what I did instead? I realized that I wasn't going to go anywhere in that bank because I didn't have a college degree. And I said, I got to have my own plan. So I had a friend of mine that worked at a savings and loan. It was called Expressway Federal Savings and Loan. It was a tiny little bank. Back then, savings and loans were savings banks. They were not commercial banks. And savings and loans would hire people without college degrees because they couldn't get the college kids to go over there. So my buddy got me a job over there to open up their checking account department. And because they were never allowed to have checking accounts until finally one day the government changed the rules, they were allowed. So I went and opened up their checking account departments, and I was their liaison between them and the commercial banks. Well, I got that job, and I did such a good job on the checking account that within 6 months, they made me the branch manager of the main office. I was like 25 years old, the branch manager of the main office of this bank. I mean, that wasn't bad for a guy without college. Now, of course, it is the branch manager of Expressway Federal Savings and Loans. Not exactly a big bank. We used to go on golf outings. And since I was one of the biggies now, my title was assistant vice president. You know, and whatever that means. And whatever it meant, it didn't make me much money. I was making less there than I was as a head teller of the commercial bank. But I had a title. And we used to go on these golf outings, me and my buddy and the bank president and all these other guys. And we'd go on the golf outings with all these big banks, you know, the real banks, you know, Citibank, Chase Bank, all these guys, right? And it was very intimidating for us because here we are, Expressway Federal Savings and Loan. We were a $60 million bank, $60 million, the whole bank. I mean, in these other banks, one of the top guys had $60 million by himself in these things. So we go to these golf outings, and I had never played golf. So I can remember the first time I was scared to death up to the tee, and all these big money bank guys are watching us tee off, and they insisted on me going first, of course. So I put the tee down there, and I'm looking at it, and I've never golfed before. And I swing and I hit the ball and it takes off like a rocket. I was like, holy cow, this is great. It hits a tree about 40 yards out. Bink, and it bounces right back and lands right at my feet. I couldn't believe it. It's just like, so I'm like, all right, now what do you do, right? So I didn't know what to do because I'd never really done that before. I was like, do you get a mulligan? I don't know, right? So I picked it up. I picked the ball up and acted like I knew what I was doing. Just picked it up and put it in my pocket. Just they were like, okay, well, so, and they, I could hear the guys from the commercial banks on the side with their, like, their scotch and water saying, so, hi, what's the name of that bank you work for? Expressway Carpet? That's what they used to call us, Expressway Carpet. Anyway, as the branch manager of the Expressway Federal Savings and Loan of the main office, I was a big wheel, so I was in charge of a lot of stuff, so... Well, I can remember one time, it was a 4th of July weekend. Again, you know, 4th of July weekend was a big weekend. And when you ordered money in a bank, you had to be very careful what you ordered. If you ordered too much money, like if you ordered like $3 million and you only used $2 million and you had $1 million in the vault on Friday night, that was an audit exception. If you were more than like 50 grand over your allotment of cash, it was an audit exception. You got in big trouble. So you had to order enough cash so that you would be left with almost none by the end of the week. So you had to kind of guess that. Well, one time I guessed wrong. It was the 4th of July weekend, so a lot of people wanted cash. And we were open late on Friday nights. So I can remember it's a Friday night, 4th of July weekend, and I was the head teller now. I mean, I was the manager now. And my head teller comes over to me. It's about 7 o'clock or so at night, and we're open until 9. And she goes, we got a problem, Mr. Hives. And I said, well, what's the problem? She goes, we're running out of cash. I'm like, what? We're a bank. We can't run out of cash. She goes, we're running out of cash. Everybody's cashing checks for the July weekend. I said, well, how much cash do we got left? Can we last? We got like 2 or 3 hours left. She goes, I don't think so. I said, what do you got left? She goes, we're down to 5s and 1s. They're down to hand out 5s and 1s. They're cashing like $300 checks with 5s and 1s. And I said, holy cow, what do we do? So I called up a buddy of mine who worked at the commercial bank on the other side of town, and I said, I need cash. Now, you're not supposed to go get cash from another bank unless you have an armored guard with you and a truck. You're not allowed to just go get cash, right? Well, it was 4th of July weekend, and there was no way I was going to order an armored truck because then I would have gotten in big trouble because it's a lot of money. And I just said, cut me a check for 200 grand. And I says, I'm going to go to the bank and get some cash. I told her, she goes, well, what do we do in the meantime? I said, start handing out traveler's checks. Okay. Back then, what's that? I love it. But you don't know what a 45 is neither, right? It's not a gun. It's my record. It's that record. It's called a 45. So traveler's checks were a little like blue. They looked like checks, but they looked like money. And what you did was when you traveled overseas, instead of having cash in your pocket, you took traveler's checks in case they were numbered so that if somebody stole them, they could cancel them. But if somebody steals cash, they got your cash. And that's then they were great. So everybody used them way, way back when. Well, we had a vault full of them. We were running out of money. So I said, start handing out traveler's checks. So they're handing out traveler's checks. So I go to this bank down the street, this commercial bank. Well, little did I know that they were having a 4th of July parade right in front of the bank branch. This is a true story, right? So I've got my cash bag in my hand. I drove as close as I could get, but I'm still about 4 blocks away from the bank because of the parade. So I had to come through this whole crowd, go in. I've got this bag of cash. It must have been this big. I mean, it was huge. And I put it into like a grocery bag. And I walked out of the bank carrying this grocery bag full of small bills, 10s and 20s. About $200,000 or $300,000 in cash, and I got it in my hand, and I'm walking through the crowds on this 4th of July weekend party thing of parade, and I got back to the bank. Well, fortunately, nobody saw me, and I got in there, and I saved the day, and we had money for the rest of the day, and that was that. So, anyway, the bank was a lot of fun. It was very much fun. So. So anyway, that was my real job, my beginnings of a real job kind of thing, from my factory to the real job. And another interesting happened when I was kind of in that stage in life of getting a real job with a suit and a tie. And that is that while I was working at the bank, I met the mom of the fellow who was managing this rock band. His name was Tony. I knew his, her mom was, name is Frankie was the mom's name. And she said, well, Tony is looking for somebody to play guitar. And I said, why? And she said, well, one of the guys in a band that he manages cut his finger. And they already booked time in a recording studio. And she said, so they need somebody to fill in and play some guitar parts while this guy heals, because they already paid for the time. So I never played in a recording studio before. And I was in a garage band before that. And I told the tape about the, I told you guys about the tape about garage band. I hadn't played in a couple of years, but I was still a guitar player. So I said, well, tell Tony to give me a call. Well, Tony calls me up and he goes, listen, I got this band that I managed. They're really pretty good. He goes, they've got about 30 songs that they've written. And we've booked time in a recording studio, and we're looking to get you or get somebody into the studio to play some lead guitar parts, because the guy, the lead guitar player, cut his finger, and they don't want to lose the time. Can you do it? And I said, yeah, are you kidding? To get to play in a real recording studio? I'd love to do it. So I ended up going to a recording studio, first time in my life to walk into a real recording studio. And I'm in there and I'm with these other guys who are like professional musician guys. They're really good. And I'm listening to their music and I'm like, holy cow, these guys are really good. So I meet the guys and I said, well, what do you want me to do? They said, very simple. I was never in a studio before. They said, we're going to play a track. You put your headphones on, you play a track, and we'll tell you what key it's in. He goes, and all you got to do is play a lead. And they said, I'll tell you what key it's in, and I'll tell you when to get in and when to get out. This was the lead singer songwriter. I was telling me, I said, oh, that sounds easy. Can you do that? I said, yeah, I play lead all the time. It's not, it comes natural to me. So as long as I know what key I'm in, I can play anything. It may not sound as good as you like, but I'll play it. So I'm in this recording studio with headphones on for the first time in my life, with they had those desks with 8 zillion knobs on them and everything, right? And I can remember sitting there with the headphones on and the guy going like this, go. And I just started playing lead in A, and then he goes, get out. And I got out. And I nailed leads on about 3 songs in one take each, maybe 2 takes. And they were like, wow, you're really good. And I'm like, well, yeah, I'm not bad, And they said, well, and I heard these guys singing in the next booth over. They were singing. And I said, well, I sing a little too. And they said, really? I said, well, I don't really sing lead. I said, but I sing. I said, I love harmony. I love Beatle harmony. They said, well, we all love Beatles. These guys were all big Beatle fans. And they said, they love harmony. I said, well, and they said, well, would you like to try and maybe sing a harmony? We have 2 guys in the band that sing. We'd love to have a third part harmony. I said, sure. So before you know it, I got the headphones on and I'm singing a third part harmony. And I got to tell you, it was just amazing to be in a recording studio, hearing yourself play guitar, hearing your vocals, and then having it come out like a real professional record. I mean, there's really no cooler feeling for a guy that was a garage band guy all his life to hear his own music played with professional guys. So I did the recordings for these guys, and I thought that was the end of it. And I got a phone call a couple of weeks later saying, would you like to come in to the rehearsal hall with us and rehearse some of the songs? We've got some showcases set up with people, management people that want to see the band, and we don't want to pass on them. And the lead guitar player's finger's still messed up. He really can't play. Would you be willing to play with us for a couple of months during this? And I said, sure, I'd love to, right? So I do all of that. Meanwhile, the lead guitar player guy, this guy named Mike, now one of my best friends, wonderful guy. He, such a good-hearted guy. He was showing me all the parts. He was encouraging me. He's showing me everything. And meanwhile, his wife was kind of this on the side, because she saw it as, and everybody thought he was training his replacement because he cut his finger up and he couldn't play that well with the cut finger. He had to get a bunch of stitches and everything. And everybody thought that I was being trained to be his replacement. But, and even he might have thought that, because he really wasn't sure how good his hand was going to come out. He cut it with a chainsaw. He was cutting trees and he tore it up. He didn't tore it up that bad, but bad enough that he couldn't play. So it didn't matter to him. What mattered to him was that the music got done and got done well. This guy was training me to take over his spot in this band. And he had such a wonderful attitude about it. helping me every way he can. So, and meanwhile, they're asking me there more and more, and I got the stupid job at the bank. And, well, at the end of the day, and, of course, my next video is going to be about the band. Of course, as you can tell, I'm kind of building it up to this band thing that finally, after me recording a lot of stuff, and the stuff came out great, they loved the way I did the stuff, and they said, you know, we'd like for you to join the band. And I said, I'm not going to take Mike's place. I said, this guy, he's a gold mine for you. He's a wonderful guy, big supporter of the band. They said, no, we don't want you to replace him. We're keeping Mike. We want to keep you and Mike, two guitar players, because you sing and you play guitar. We thought if we had two guitar players and a third vocalist, we'd be better off. So it worked out that his finger healed, and he's a great guitar player, way better than me. I'm a pretty good guitar player, but he's a real rock and roll kind of guy. And I ended up saying, well, I got a decision to make now. I'm working at a bank. I cut my hair. I wish I didn't cut it. Now I cut it, right? And now I've got this opportunity to go on the road with a rock and roll band, a real rock and roll band. So what did I say? I thought about it for a minute, and I said to the bank president, because now I was the VP, I said, take this job and shove it. Because it really wasn't banking. It was babysitting. That's what I did most of the time at that bank. It was always, the girls showed up late. They had problems. They were in the bathroom when the thing went open. I'd say, where's Linda? She's in the girls' room again. We're supposed to open at 9 o'clock. This one girl, Linda, she was the best teller I had. But she was never on time. Always late. And I gave her a lecture one day, and I said, you better be in this building ready to work at you know, 8:50, because we open at 9, or you're fired next time. And she was just like, oh, okay, Mr. Hypes, right? So next day, 10 to 9, where's Linda? She's not here. I'm like, I can't believe it. No, wait a minute. Oh, she's here. She's in the ladies' room. All right. At 9 o'clock, she's not up at the telestation. I go down to the ladies' room. I'm like, Linda, what? You in there? Yeah, it's 9:05. I know. You're fired. F you. That's what she said right through the door. And then she got out. She gave me the finger and she left. That's not banking. That's babysitting in my mind. So I really didn't care too much about the banking job. So I quit my job at the bank, and I decided to go on the road to rock and roll band. And the next chapter that I'm going to tell you about is all about my escapades with the rock and roll band. Have a good one.